Yeah, so welcome to this second part of the webinar that I'm doing right now. So for those who don't know me, my name is Maciej. I'm the marketing director of Veriphi. We are a Montreal-based consultancy and exchange, Bitcoin exchange group in Montreal. So for the kind of services we offer, for example, for people that have a lot of Bitcoin, we create all the security system needed in order to protect them the right way. And we also currently launching a platform, a non-custodial platform on which all Canadians are going to be able to buy Bitcoin through a non-custodial way. So if you're interested in either of these, maybe after the presentation, after you understand why Bitcoin is good money, don't hesitate to contact me directly and I'll be happy to provide assistance for any Bitcoin needs that you may have now or in the future. So just a quick recap on the concept of these presentations. So we are doing a lot of presentations through the Bitcoin Montreal meetup group, and some of them are really technical and really in-depth for a lot of subjects, and they're mostly directed for more technical people. So that's why I wanted to like do a back to the source presentation. And so this is the second one from the three that I'm doing, the first one being about Bitcoin's technology. So this is already up on the Bitcoin Montreal YouTube channel. I'm going to be providing all the links at the end of the presentation. So today we're going to talk more about everything that's related more to the economy. So I won't be talking about how Bitcoin works exactly, because that's a whole set of new, that's a whole presentation on its own. So if there's something that you don't understand in regards of the technology today, you can go back and look at it on the Bitcoin Montreal YouTube channel. I'm gonna talking more about the history of money and what led us to the current situation that we have today. And because I think it's important to understand the history of money before understanding why Bitcoin is good money. So as you may see in today's like record sales through different companies, a lot of people are investing into Bitcoin, and big companies are also investing their cash reserves into Bitcoin because some of them believe that inflation is coming. A lot of bad things may happen in regards of the value of our money. So it's a good question to have right now. Should I invest in Bitcoin and why? But before you do, it's better to understand the nature of money and why Bitcoin may replace it, or at least be a good alternative for it. So if I could describe Bitcoin attributes that makes it good money, it's really about being decentralized, the fact that it's scarce, so there's not a lot of Bitcoin, and that the fact also it's censorship resistant, so there's nobody that can stop you from using Bitcoin whenever you want, simply because there's no central entity that controls it. So Bitcoin was really born out of the dream of some of a group of people on the internet, in the early internet, that were called the cypherpunks, and they were looking kind of for a way to express themselves without being controlled, and also being able to transact and do an economy without the overseeing of a central government. So that's where Bitcoin was born. But let's get back to the beginning of any economical interaction between humans. It was really more about barter. So barter was really the first system in which humans started to exchanging goods between themselves, because before the humans were really more in smaller tribes, so they weren't really interacting with other people other than the specific set of 50 to 100 people, and the men were doing the hunting, the women were doing the gathering of plants of whatever, and that was the kind of a really niche economies between themselves, and there was no concept of money because everybody was sharing everything between themselves. But then some tribes started to interact between each other, and some of them were perhaps on a certain geographical location where there was a certain resources that the other tribes wanted, And on the contrary, the same thing. So they started exchanging some stuff, some artisanal objects, or some food or anything that really they wanted on both sides. But the problem with that system, it's really limited because you need a coincidence of wants and needs. So for example, if the only thing that you have to offer are cows, and the other party, the only thing that he can offer is our apples. Well, if you don't want apples, or the other party doesn't want any cows, well, how do you do the exchange, right? And also the fact that the resources that you want to exchange in that moment is not necessarily divisible. Like a cow, you can give a half a cow because you're gonna kill the cow, and of course that doesn't make sense. And the same as with apples, for example, they're gonna rot at a certain point, so it's not a great way to preserve the potential value that exchanges, that that economical exchange did at that point. So what will be needed in that case really is the money, right? So you need a certain good that does the intermediary between this exchange and serves for both as a way to preserve the value, and maybe perhaps buy something else in the future or exchange it for something else. So rapidly after people discovered the limitation of the barter system, they started using other commodities or other resources as money in order to make this transaction more scalable and more user-friendly, I would say, because as I just did an example with cows and apples, but that could be practically anything. And in all of them, all of these situations, the limitation were apparent. So depending on the geographical location, people and societies that have been living in this specific geographies, they were mostly using what was at their hands to use as money, but it was also they were often choosing a resource that was scarce or as kind of scarce in certain kind of sense, because if you just could create that resource out of nothing, well, it was easy. Why would you like to exchange a good that you produce for something that you can pick on the ground as well? It doesn't make any sense. So I put some examples here, but all these commodities, all these resources have failed as money because they were not really good proponents for it. So for example, in the beginning, when salt was really precious, before it was mass-produced, industrialized, like in today's economies, it was used in money in a lot of cases. And the same for coffee in some places. And for example, some shells that you can find on the ground in a specific area, they could have been rare because they were not close to the sea. But somebody could travel maybe 50 kilometers, miles down the road, and he could find a beach full of shells and come back with it, and that will break the perceived value that specific community had, because at their place the shells were scarce. And here's a really interesting example. On the left, you can see there's a man standing close to a big rock with a hole in it. So that was a really interesting monetary system that happened in the Yap Islands. It's in Indonesia, in the last millennial. Well, basically what happens, the on the island themselves, there weren't a lot of rocks like that, so they were retrieving these rocks and sculpting them and bringing them back on the island, and that required a lot of work and danger, and that was kind of difficult. So when these rocks were brought back to the islands, they had this perceived notion of value because they were hard to bring back. And at some point, the system, and also one of the factors that was making a certain type of rock more valuable was the history of it. So if the rock was ancient and was exchanged through the generation multiple times, it was worth more. But one thing that happened bad for this monetary system is that at some point there was a Irish sailor that come that saw that system, and he said, "Well, for me, it's easier because I have bigger boats. I can bring back a lot of rocks and exchange it for the resources they have on this island." And that's what he did, and it was much easier for him. And some of the people on the islands were saying, "Well, it's nice. We can become much richer because there's all these rocks coming in." And but some other proponents of that system were saying, "Well, it's not the same thing because they didn't bring that rock through the hardship that we had to go through. So these rocks don't have any value, right?" And they were kind of right, because as soon as these rocks started to flowing in the island, these rocks just came back to what they are really, and it's just rocks with big holes with it, and this stopped being money. So as you can see in history, people have been using a lot of different resources and stuff as money, and that's fine. But the thing is, as soon as a certain property of money is broken, well, that resource in particular becomes obsolete, and people move on to another form of money. So all the things I described here, there's really four big functions of money. And one of the most important, in my opinion, is the store of value function, because if you have a certain type of money that loses its value in the future, it's kind of worth not less. It's kind of worthless. But also, what is really important, the fact that you need a medium of exchange, so you don't exchange your good directly for a certain good that the other person produced. You exchange it for money, and you also value the resources and services and products in a certain society through one specific unit of account. So when you go to the store now, everything is going to be valued. If you're from Canada, everything is going to be valued in Canadian dollars, and as opposed to going into a store and everything is, some items are priced in Bitcoin, some price are priced in Canadian dollars, some price are priced in USD dollars. So that will be confusing and really hard for people to quickly conceive and know what is the value of a certain object, because they don't have a unit of account. And that, I think that also the fourth function that is kind of omitted a lot of time is when people are saying, well, money should serve as a way for standard for deferred payment. And so basically, if somebody takes a credit with you, or you give a credit to someone, you want to make sure that you're repaid with the same amount of money, because that's much easier to know how much is worth, how much will be worth to you in the future. And that comes with the fact that it's also that it should be a store of value, because if you're being repaid in the same money that someone has take a credit with you, in the future, you want to make sure that money in the future is worth something. So that's the biggest functions of money. And when a certain form of money comes into existence in a certain society, it must fulfill these functions to be good money. So eventually, as you saw, maybe some societies were using more perishable goods like coffee, like shells and this kind of stuff. But quickly people realized that metals, especially precious metals, were a good form of money, because they were really good at what we're doing, like, so basically fulfilling well the functions, the four functions of money I just talked about. And so as you could see really in the beginning of a lot of cultures, with the usage of gold and silver, for example, but mostly gold, I would say, since the beginning. And for example, the first people that thought of putting gold into coin pieces was 500 years before the year zero. So it's really something that people have been doing for a lot of time, for a long time, and nobody has told them really, like, oh, you have to believe this rock, this shiny golden rock, is worth something. Well, it's just really organically emerged as good money between a lot of culture. And almost practically everywhere. So we see usage of gold in Asia, Europe, Africa, America. So really anywhere that was like the conclusion, natural conclusion, and through an organic process of discovering what is the best form of money. And more really often we say that, for example, gold is sound money because it really requires a lot of work to be put out of the ground. So you can't just create it out of nothing, like you could plant a, for example, like you could plant a tree, coffee tree, and have a lot of beans, and that would, so in a society where like coffee beans would be good money, you would just have to plant some trees, and that'll make the job. But gold doesn't work like that. So you have to dig, and it takes a lot of work. You have to employ people, you have to have machinery, you have to have expertise. So because of that difficulty to create that money, well, not create it, but find it in the ground, that's why it's kind of scarce, right? Because you just can't just like print it out of anything. And for example, during the medieval times, a lot of people were calling themselves alchemists, and they were trying to create gold out of nothing to become rich. But of course, they didn't succeed because gold is a metal. It has chemical properties that you can just create out of nothing. So that's why it has been used as money. So then you once people have discovered this really good form of money, which is gold and silver and precious metals, of course you can start building on top of that system, which is just the layer foundation of a monetary system. So of course there's some proofs of a lot of ledger accounting and this kind of stuff since a long time. But if we talk, by example, of the big step in regards of the evolution of money, we could say that the rise of the banks and like really banks, the creation of banks as we know them today, are a big part of that evolution. Because basically, even though if gold is really good money, it also has some drawbacks. So for example, the fact that it's really heavy, the fact that if you want to transfer it to another city, to another country, you have to travel long distances, and that can be dangerous because along the road, people can steal it from you, they can attack you, they can kill you, and so that's pretty bad. So the invention of banks come really from the needs of people making safe transaction across, for example, across long distances, and security, right? So that's why in the 14th century, the kind of banks that we use today have started to emerge. Of course, they're quite different than today. So for in some cities like Florence, Venice, and Genoa, that's where really the banking revolution, the banking system started to be created. And that's really, we could argue that these banks are offering a really good service because they're protecting your wealth, and you don't have all these risks of having to travel across the globe just to send some gold and shiny rock. What you can do is you have a set of network, you have a network of trusted partners of banks through different cities, and you don't have to travel with the gold. What you can do is basically do a change in the general ledger of these banks and do just an accounting trick when you say, well, this gold is here, but I want to pay a certain guy the gold is in Florence, but I need to pay a certain supplier of something in Venice. So I'm just going to send a note to the bank in Venice saying, well, debit that much of gold from my name and put it to the name of this person or this company. So because of that, gold has started to be like hoarded by bigger banks, and that also created a lot of system on top of this. So since gold is kept in one place, what you can do as well, and much more easily and in a scalable way, is to create a new form of money, which is credit. So credit pretty much is just a a note saying, well, I owe you that much, but it's not gold. It's just a promise of future payment of a certain amount of gold, for example. So for the fact that you have a base where you have a certain amount of gold, but you can also lend that gold to other people, even if you don't have it all of it in your vaults, because not everybody is going to retrieve the gold at the same time. So you can always create credits and basically do a what's called a fractional reserve with your money, because it's kept in a bank. So you can expand that function through credit and a promise of future payments. So that's also what helped, for example, I forgot to say that a lot of people attribute the fact that Europe went through an age of enlightenment in the 17th century and during a lot of centuries, and you saw a lot of discoveries in regards to science and everything, because you had this appropriate set of economical conditions and also security to do credit and do businesses that expand societies and everything. So credit was a good way to for example, if somebody wants to invest in a business, you want to take a credit first in order to do so. So that has been quite fulfilling and quite good for society as a whole. So that was more like the really early history and until the advent of banks and the creation of the concept of credit. But I also wanted to do a quick recap in regards of the modern history of money, what led to our current situation where we have Canadian dollars, where we have American dollars, where we have the yuan, we have the euro. So what happened before we were using gold and we had much more of a gold standard, but today we just have fiat money, which is basically just paper money. So everything kind of began with the executive order 6102. Of course, there's a lot of events, so I kind of simplified them just to give them more important points. So basically that was happening just after the big crash in 29. The Federal Reserve and the central the government of the USA, they wanted to repatriate all the gold that the citizen had as personal belongings in order to preserve their value, because they wanted to stimulate the economy through the creation of their own money, which is the US dollar. So they issued an order which is famously known through Bitcoiners as Order 6102. And the order was basically saying, well, all the citizens should give all their gold back to the government. And as a payment for that, we're going to issue you dollars at a fixed rate, which was fixed at the time at 1 ounce was valued at $20.67. And if somebody was not complying, well, they could risk up to 10 years in prison and $10 worth of fine. At the time, it was really a big fine. Well, and also read that actually wasn't that successful. It was, I think, only like 20% of people gave back their gold. Well, these are some estimation, but just the fact that people have the power to issue that kind of order saying, well, you give me back your gold, I'm gonna issue, which is basically a money that has been respected by humanities and societies since forever, and for that I'm gonna give you some dollars that were created by me. So just the fact that they have that option is kind of worrisome for a lot of people. So then after this, one of the big events that actually created the system that we have today is the Bretton Woods Agreement that happened in 1945 after the second World War. So when the Allied nations won, they get the option to create the new system in which all the countries, whenever these are the winners or the losers of the war, they function. So because the USA were the main driver of that victory, they really had the full power of creating this new system, which is all drafted and created through the Bretton Woods Agreement. So Bretton Woods is just like a location in the United States. So you have all these states actors and really powerful people. They met in a hotel and they set what is the current part of the current system that we have right now. So basically what the Bretton Woods Agreement said is basically, well, we as the US government are going to hold the gold and hold a lot of the gold that is existing on the planet, and we're going to give a fixed rate. We're going to have a certain rate of dollars. We're going to also create the dollar that is going to be backed by this gold that we keep, and all the other currencies on the planet, whenever it's France or whatever, are going to be backed by the US dollar, but only the US dollar is going to be backed by gold. So this gave them power a lot, but it was still like kind of a gold standard, because you still had the promise of the US dollar being backed by gold. And that happened, so for the next 20-30 years, we saw a huge boom in economies across the world. A lot of evolution in regards to human development indexes, and basically poverty being reduced a lot in a lot of countries, because you still had that perception that the money that was being used was backed in the final by a sound money, which was gold. Unfortunately, that system ended in 1971, when Nixon said, actually, it's going to be really just temporary before we take back the gold standard. And so he said basically that the US dollar isn't backed by the gold anymore, and everybody do what they want nationally, on the national level, with their own money. So that really introduced the concept of fiat money, which is basically just a promise of coming from a government that the money it creates is just legal tender, but it's not backed on anything. So during the Bretton Woods Agreement, you had the countries that were backing their currencies by the US dollar that was backed by the gold, the gold that they were holding. But now it's basically free for all, do whatever you want. And all the countries basically right now are not basing their currency on the gold reserves they have. They just can print as much as they want. And when I say print, it's not literally just papers, but also through the issuance of government bonds and everything. So that's the birth of the system that we have right now. But the problem is that with fiat, you have a lot of unexpected consequences, because you put a really big power into the hands of really a small group of people that isn't necessarily elected democratically, and everything is kind of happening behind closed doors. And the system is really complicated, and to think that someone can manage it for a long time without going through a mistake once, it's really improbable. And we have all these examples of inflation, so, and also hyperinflation. So you may have heard that in Venezuela, for example, during just the last decade, and especially the last few years, there has been a lot of hardships, economical hardships, and that can be attributed a lot to hyperinflation. So you have an example here where it's showing how much money is needed to buy just a simple chicken, and that just doesn't make sense. And basically, since the government is printing so much money, before you can spend it, it already has lost its value. So you have this system where price can adjust rapidly enough and everything is breaks down really, because it just isn't an efficient way to value anything in the society if the money keeps losing value, because it's just like kicking down the can down the road all the time. So it's just showing how much this system doesn't make really sense. And it's not just in Venezuela, it's happening in Lebanon as well right now, it's happening in Argentina, it's happening in a lot of countries and keep happening. And you also have the effect, the really negative effect. Well, it can be really profitable for some, but for most of the people, the Cantillon effect is really bad too, because since the issuance of new money is going all through the same source, before it reaches the population, it's gonna go through all these this funnel where the central bank is gonna print or create some new money. The first one that are gonna receive it are governments or really big firms or other big banks, commercial banks. And they, because they receive this influx and this stimulus of new money, they have the ability to profit from it before it loses the value when it reaches really down the population. And because of that, so it's always when new money is being created, it always benefits the most powerful people that are part of that funnel. But once it reaches us, well, you just have things going, things that are just more expensive. But your, for example, your how much you're getting paid at your job doesn't adjust quickly enough to that inflation, so that can be bad and you lose purchasing power. So even if the biggest threat of yam money can be said as hyperinflation, because it's really then that you have a complete economic collapses and everything. Even for the dollar, which is considered as the biggest currency and the most trusted, and everybody is basically using across the globe, even the people that hates the U.S. governments. Well, the thing is, if you take the value of $1 in 1913, it's only going to be worth like 4 cents today. So, since for like in the last 100 years. That can seem a lot, but it's really 2-3 generations. The U.S. dollar has lost 96% of its value, and it's kind of worrying, you know. And that's bad, because if you have a business, you have a family, you wanna invest, you wanna have money that you can transmit to your kids. And it loses value. It doesn't make sense that you have worked so far, so hard and long, and the government just doesn't care, and he creates more of it, so it's worth less. So it's kind of worrisome. So, see, I talked a lot about the past history of money and why we have this system today. And for me, really, digital money was the next evolution, more specifically Bitcoin. And for me, Bitcoin, in a second I will explain, it's really more like a coming back to a certain form of a gold standard. And because that gold was kind of hijacked by governments, by central banks, and finally they said, well, your money isn't backed by gold, we're just going to create more of it, but they still have the gold, right? So we have to come back to a certain type of a really stable monetary base that is in control, that you can create out of nothing. And in my opinion, Bitcoin is that solution. So as we can see here, of course, in order to understand why Bitcoin has these properties mentioned here, you have to understand how the technology of Bitcoin works. And so that could take a lot, and I explain all of it in the first presentation. So if you want to understand these properties here, well, you should go back and listen to the presentation to understand why it's so. So you just have to trust me today and take it for granted that I'm saying the truth. So the fact that Bitcoin is decentralized, it's it's a great way to know that it's not going to be hijacked by a central party or a central government that may started playing with it and changing the rules. And the fact that it's predictable and scarce, there's only, you've probably heard about that, there's only 21 billion bitcoins that are going to be created. And that makes it comparable to gold because you can't just create it out of nothing. And people right now are scared. They're anxious of what the government might do with monetary stimuluses, with fiscal stimuluses. So I think people are starting to think about the nature itself of their money, what's in their wallet, and the fact that Bitcoin has this really simple and understandable features that practically anybody can understand if he delves into it a few hours or a few or put any thoughts in it. I think, in my opinion, that that's gonna bring people to Bitcoin. And the fact also that it's censorship resistance, it's censorship resistant is one of the biggest factor why Bitcoin is good money, because nobody can stop it from using it. So right now, if you have some Canadian dollars or US dollars in your bank account, you want to do a transaction and the bank doesn't like it, well, they're going to say, no, I'm not transferring your money because it's not really your money. I have the whole control of it. And sometimes you want to go to the bank and say, well, I want to take back my money. They're going to ask you why. And should you be forced to say why it's your money? Like, they don't have, why should they be like into your life so much, right? So the fact that Bitcoin doesn't ask and you can just do whatever you want, in my opinion, that's going to be needed a lot in the upcoming years. If, for example, there's bank runs or whatever that can happen bad in the future. So these are all the desirable properties that I think makes Bitcoin good money, and people are starting to understand it and they invest in Bitcoin exactly for that, these reasons. And another thing that I really like about Bitcoin as being money is the fact that it's really evolved through an organic process. So as the same as gold, nobody has forced anybody to believe that gold has some value. It's just a perceived shared notion of the fact that gold is valuable to everybody that makes it valuable to everybody, right? To a certain extent. You also have the fact that, well, it takes energy, it takes a lot of work to retrieve it from the ground. Well, Bitcoin, it's kind of the same thing, right? So if somebody says to you, well, Bitcoin has no value, it's worth zero, when, well, I don't really care what you think because some other people are believing that it's worth something actually, so I'm just gonna exchange it with them. And it doesn't matter if some people believe it has value or not, because some people do. So it really evolved organically. So in the beginning, of course, Bitcoin was worth absolutely nothing. It was just like a project between a few nerds. And one of them said in 2010, well, I'm gonna pay 10,000 bitcoins to someone who delivers two pizza at my house. And somebody said, well, okay, I'm gonna do it. And because of that, it valued for the first time Bitcoin to at least, well, 10,000 bitcoins were worth what? Two pizzas are what? $20, $30. So it gave the like the first valuation of Bitcoin, proving that it may be useful for some people. And you know, that's history, and everything after that happened until today, and people are buying Bitcoin today. And you can also see that during all these years, the 11 years that Bitcoin existed, you have all these system creating companies, industries developing this system even more. So one of the thing you need a lot in a really a global money system like that is liquidity. So if you want to sell your bitcoins, whenever it's a really big amount or a smaller one, your smaller amount, you want to have the guarantee that you can sell it whenever you want. So you have all these exchanges right now, growing and growing all the time, offering the service of liquidity, the ability to exchange your bitcoin whenever you need it. you'll have all these companies, the same as banks were developing, in the 14th century in some cities in Italy. You have all these systems creating a security system for Bitcoins, right? And nobody forced them to do that. They just see the need, and people are having that need, and they do it. And apart from that, you also have all these new financial product created on top of Bitcoin. So, for example, some people are offering the chance of receiving an annual yield on your Bitcoin funds, the same as credit and fractional reserve happened on gold all these centuries ago. So we really can see that Bitcoin is taking a path where it doesn't care what some people think about it. Some people believe it has value and it's going to grow in value in the future. And everything indicates that, well, it's not going to stop here. And of course, the concept of value and why people value something, it's really complicated in some kind of sense, because it's really a perceived notion between a lot of people that something has value. But we can also argue that because Bitcoin, and you see that if you don't understand Bitcoin technology, that may be hard to understand with just a simple graph, right? So, it takes a lot of work and energy to find the Bitcoins, right, through the proof of work process. And basically, it doesn't stop growing since the beginning, and we just reached a new all-time high in terms of hashing power that is being deployed on the Bitcoin network. So that indicates that people are working hard through their computers, I would say, to make Bitcoin secure, and because they want the Bitcoins a lot. So if we just calculate the how much hash rate is being deployed on Bitcoin and divide it by the most popular mining machine that existed that exists, which is the S9, it's around 10 million S9s that are machines, computers that are being deployed on the Bitcoin network in order to secure it. So you can argue that because there's a lot of energy being put in Bitcoin, that also gives it value in some kind of sense. And of course, there's a lot of other things that justifies the fact that Bitcoin is worth something. But it's also the fact that it's just people are believing that it may be worth in the future, and it may be good money for them. So that's what they're doing. So are we crazy? Are we the people that are gonna shoot themselves in the foot at some point because we're just believing a stupid dream of having a decentralized digital money? Well, I don't think so. I think some people have this dream and this vision as well, and we can see it. We can see a lot of examples where that trust and that belief manifests itself in real life events. So, for example, that was really surprising news and really taken well by the Bitcoin community. There's a company called MicroStrategy that invested basically all their cash reserve into Bitcoin with a letter explaining in detail why they believe it's a good move for the upcoming years. And that shows that even it's not just crazy people on Twitter that are saying that Bitcoin is going to be the reserve asset of this world, comparing to gold. It's basically big companies valued on the Nasdaq that believe so as well. And just the fact also that more and more regulation are helping companies developing crypto products and Bitcoin products and easing the regulations, it's showing that there's an interest in that coming from the big boys as well. So that was my overview of why Bitcoin is good money and why you should invest in it, in my opinion, in order to preserve the value of your savings, of your work. And as always, as promised, through the presentation, you can also win $10 worth of Bitcoin today. So the only thing that you have to do is to go on Veriphi's page on Facebook, And actually, like the latest post, and if you learn something new today, or if you like the presentation today, except for the trolls that insurge and attack the presentation, just do that. And the people commenting, I'll be sending Bitcoins for anybody that does it. So, and also if you think that some friends or some acquaintances of yours are will be interested into learning Bitcoin more and diving into that subject, don't hesitate to also invite them to like the page. That would be great for us and a great way to spread the Bitcoin message. So thank you for again. Sorry again about the presentation, the situation at the beginning. We hope it's not going to happen again. So as I mentioned and in the beginning, this is part of a three webinar series. So the next one is happening exactly 1 week time on the 3rd of September at the same time. And I'm going to talk more about the future of Bitcoin, what in terms of technology, but also in terms of economical perspectives and everything. So here you have a link. You have a link for a Verify page. I'm going to put it on in the chat in a second. And you can go also on Bitcoin Montreal on YouTube to see the past presentation and everything. And of course, if you're interested in buying Bitcoin, don't hesitate to contact me. I will be happy to put you on the beta list of our exchange and see if you have any feedbacks in that regard. So thank you very much, and I'll be taking questions if there are any. So thank you for those who are here. Scott, you asked, don't you think it's strange that we need a legacy banking system to grow the BTC market? Well, I don't think we need them necessarily, but the reality is that Bitcoin right now, for example, is being held a lot through institutions such as Coinbase, and for me, they're just like the new banks forming on top of the Bitcoin network. And I think it's a question of balancing how much people are understanding and keeping their Bitcoins the right way, as real Bitcoiners do, and basically as you will do the same with gold, holding it at your house or at some location that you control. But is it strange? I think it's just natural way of Bitcoin becoming more relevant and more important for everybody. So yeah, I don't think it's strange. I think it's just a natural evolution of Bitcoin. And you can love it, you can hate it, but it's happening, and you can yeah. So that's my opinion. Please, I don't know what you think. No. Yeah, that's the thing. So there's, this legacy system, what's really their power? Their power is in the fact that they do the regulations, and they have to make these regulations hard and nonsensical because they want to remain in power. So they're going to keep doing that, in my opinion. So before some investors are ready to jump on the Bitcoin train before all these regulations happen, and the only way it can happen is through self-custody, or at least custodying your Bitcoins to some people that you trust. And but the problem really is like all the new financial products that want to be built on top of Bitcoin, they're gonna happen as well. But yeah, that's true. So I think there's no more question. Well, I think just the banks don't want to lose the business of custodying Bitcoin because it's a good business, because then you can lend it, you can do whatever you want. You're right. So thank you for everybody. That was really nice having you here and listening to what I have to say. Oh, okay, you have a question. Sorry. Andres, yes. You can also talk if you want. So, Andres, you have a question? Maybe it's a long question. The best price of Bitcoin? Well, it depends on how much you're buying, and there's different platforms. One of them that is really cheap. It's called Newton, but it's a custodial platform. You have a pretty cheap fees. If not, I recommend Bold Bitcoin because they deliver immediately the Bitcoin to you. And as well, if we don't have the best price, but we have the best customer service. So if you wanna buy with us, it's not that expensive, and we're more competitive than a lot of platforms, but this is also an option as well. But if not, I recommend Newton and Bold Bitcoin. So yeah, that's pretty much it. Thank you much for listening. And if you have any questions or want to talk to me directly, don't hesitate. You can also shoot me a message at Thank you and have a great day. Thank you, and hope to see you in the next presentation as well.